the internet. And as usual, YouTube is a little bit slow, but it looks like we are getting close. Almost there. And there we are. We're live. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to yet another episode of Watching the Watchers Live. My name is Robert Gruler. I am a criminal defense attorney here at the R&R Law Group in Scottsdale, Arizona, where my team and I, over the course of many years, we've helped represent many thousands of people facing criminal charges throughout the state of Arizona. And over the course of those years in practice, we unfortunately have seen a lot of misconduct, a lot of malfeasance, a lot of problems in our justice system. And of course, we want to make sure that we can deal with those things because we as a society don't want those endless problems permeating throughout our justice system. Specifically, as you've been seeing around the country, we've identified problems with the police, malfeasance involving prosecutors, judicial misconduct, and of course, even political misconduct, which is the subject of the show. We are 1 week out from Election Day. Literally today is 1 week from when we had the big night and we did the five-hour live stream on this channel, and a lot has happened in that 1 week. And so today, we're going to do a deep dive on updates sort of from all over the place with a key focus on the legal aspect of what is happening with this election. Today, we're going to go through and learn a little bit more about what the Republicans are literally doing right now. There is a Republican strategist who put out a video yesterday. I watched the whole thing. I want to detail that so you can understand what sort of the alternative approach is here for the Republicans to start securing back some votes in their efforts to flip this election back into their favor. We're also going to talk about the lawsuit that Donald Trump's team has filed in the District of Pennsylvania. It's an 85-page complaint plus all of the different orders. There's a lot in there. We're going to dissect some of that. We also learned yesterday that Attorney General Bill Barr authorized the U.S. Department of Justice to start investigating additional claims of voter fraud and electoral fraud. And we've got his memorandum that we're going to go through as well so you can see what is taking place there. A lot of headlines that are flying around the media today where they're saying that, you know, what he's doing is unprecedented and he's politicizing the Justice Department. But we're going to actually read his memorandum and we're going to see what that has to say. Then, of course, we've got some more, you know, some of the quirky election stuff. What's going on out there, right? They're still gathering a lot of evidence, but there are a lot of kind of issues that people around the internet are popping up. And so we're going to cover some of those things, specifically a voting glitch that may be sort of, you know, reoccurring in Wisconsin and some other locations around the country. We've also got a little bit of some information from a forensic data analyst. His name is Mark Nigrini. We're going to talk through his analysis of Maricopa County, which is right here, right where we're living. And we're going to talk about Benford's law yet again, but I want to do it because it's so important. And then we're going to talk a little bit about something that happened late last night on Twitter called Maidengate. And that is interesting as well. So if you're not a regular of the channel, now's a good time to hit the subscribe. We go live every day at this time. And as always, we save our live chat for the end of the broadcast. So if you want to send in questions or send in super chats or any of that stuff, feel free to do that throughout the sort of informational part of the program. And then Faith is going to be clipping all of that and passing those off to me so that I can be sure that they're addressed by the end of the program. All right, so let's get into it. Let's start with some context. I want to sort of flesh out and frame this whole thing out because it's literally only a week from Election Day. It's only been 7 days. And many people are saying that this whole thing's over. The election is over. It's done. Joe Biden is the president-elect. We have this office of the president-elect. Their transition team is starting and all this stuff. And the election really isn't over. It's not actually over yet, right? Many people are saying this. And they're sort of being, I think, silenced to a certain extent. People are saying you're sort of out there if you're saying that there may still be some more to go on this thing. And so I want to show you, we talked about this yesterday, you can look up the rules, but this is the actual breakdown. This is where we're at. Election Day was 1 week ago. We are here at the smiley face. And Electors Day is on December 14th. And they have a safe harbor provision that takes place a week earlier, around the 7th and the 8th, in order to rectify a lot of these potential problems. But my point here is we've got a lot of game left. Okay, there's a lot of lane left on the tarmac. This plane has not taken off yet one way or the other. We've got the rest of these 7 days, and we have several other weeks, basically a whole other month and a week until the official Electors Day takes place. And that is the day where the state legislatures promote their assigned electors. They certify the election. They pass all of that off to the election committee and the board. And then that is when the states certify their electoral votes. So up until that time, unless the states are moving more quickly, the deadline is not until the end of or the middle of December, December 14th. And you're seeing now a lot of different lawsuits that are filed by the Trump campaign and by GOP and by, you know, the different various factions around the country. They're all filing lawsuits, and the first thing that they're asking for is an injunction against certifying the election. You're going to see that when we get into that in this in the Trump breakdown, his new lawsuit out of Pennsylvania. But you're just seeing this. They're demanding in their lawsuits that there are injunctions in place to stop the states from certifying the upcoming election. And they want to do that because it's just a procedural thing. They have to stop. You know, if they certify it and everything is done and closed, then it's a lot more difficult to rewind the clock back a little bit. So the first order of business is to put a pause in the normal operations that are taking place in the state, and then they can go in and make their more substantive claims or actually have the court proceedings that are going to sort of weed through each and every one of those claims. So typically, you know, typical stuff, pretty normal. They're always going to ask them to stop what they're doing and open up the door for further inquiry. And that's where we're at. So just another, you know, refresher. There's a lot of game left on this. Now, just because there's a lot of time doesn't necessarily mean that things are going to change. Donald Trump still has a significant hurdle here. I did a breakdown, pulled these numbers over from Bloomberg this morning, and he's got a significant hurdle, right? There's a lot of votes out there that are not in his favor. And so when you break this down here, you'll see that the vote balance between Trump and Joe Biden in each one of these different battleground states where Donald Trump is losing, you know, allegedly in each one of those, the delta here, the difference in the votes, when you add them all up, it's 300,000 votes. Okay, and that's a lot of votes, right? If somebody is actually sitting in front of a ballot collection machine and inserting votes, that's a lot. Now, if you break that down over 300 people and they each have 1,000 ballots, it's a little bit more of a manageable task. Or if you have one person who's just, you know, hyperloading these things or what, you know, however it worked, the point is 300,000 people, that's a lot of people. And as we go through this, you're going to see that a lot of the Republican strategists, they're part of what they're having to do is identify all of those different people. They're trying to find 300,000 people to flip the votes. And so that's why many people in the media, and rightfully so, are saying, whoa, this is a big deal. This is a long shot. You know, how are they possibly going to go out and you know, reverse how these states have already been called? It is a tall order. It's a lot of granular data analysis. They have to really break this thing down and identify those people. And so to do that 300,000 times, if you think about this sort of like a pipeline, if you have to go and actually change 300,000 votes, how many people do you have to talk to in order to identify 300,000 people who are willing to do something about it to change their votes, right? It's a big, big number. And so even if you said, okay, you know, maybe it's 10% of the people actually respond, now you're talking about, you know, talking to 3 million people in order to wean this thing down, in order to flip the votes of the 300,000 votes. And so that is sort of the standard, you know, media talking point. Oh, it's insurmountable. This whole thing is a foregone conclusion. It's so many votes, there's no way. And I can understand their point in large part, because it is. There's six different states on this list, and the numbers look pretty dramatic across the board, right? We got 14,000 in Arizona, 146,000 in Michigan. You think that's certainly a foregone conclusion. Donald Trump's down almost 50,000 votes in Pennsylvania and so on. And it's a lot. It's a lot of people. But if you go through and you have some pretty significant rulings, so for example, as we're going to see when we get to the Pennsylvania case, if they suddenly invalidate any of the votes that came in after Election Day, as I think that they will, in fact, then that may take that 40,000 numbers and just 49,000 votes in Pennsylvania and just flip them, because it's such a big chunk. And that's what a lot of the Republicans are looking for. And that's what I think is going to be consequential for this election. Now, if they're not able to find that, if they're going through voter by voter and they're just saying this person, you know, didn't use the secret envelope, and they identify one person, you know, little Mary, who's, you know, 85 years old in the backwoods rural area of Pennsylvania, you know, that's not a big win for the Republicans. And so that's what a lot of the people, the Democrats and the people in the media are saying, that this is just, it's so much that it's not going to happen. Now, The other reason I wanted to pull these numbers up is because I wanted to show you specifically that the claim that this stuff needs to be widespread. We saw this in Jake Tapper's tweet yesterday where he said there's no credible evidence of any widespread fraud. And they're moving the goalpost a little bit. So now what they're doing is saying that it has to be widespread in order for it to matter. And it doesn't. It really doesn't. It actually needs to be very, very targeted and not widespread at all. Because if you do the math on this, and I'm a lawyer, I don't do math too well. That's why I went to law school. But you can fact check me on this. But if there's 331 million people in the United States, and we're talking about 300,000 votes, that's less than 0.1% of the population is responsible for the delta in the votes. If less than 0.1% of people flipped their votes, theoretically, Donald Trump would be the next president. So it's not that widespread. They just need to target in and identify some of those counties where it's very, very, you know, it's very abnormal when the counties have extra votes or we're seeing some votes flip. So it's not a widespread thing that they're looking for. This is very, it's a lot of numbers, but it's pretty targeted. And if they're able to identify some big chunks, 50,000 votes here and there, then that, you know, six of those, that's 300,000 votes. The election turns the other way. All right. So who's going to help guide us through the Republican strategy? Who is sort of leading the forefront of this thing? Well, I don't know I think there's a lot of people around the country who are all sort of picking up the ball in their own way, and they're moving forward to investigate the election. Somebody who I found to be very credible, and I thought he gave an excellent explanation, is this fellow. He goes by the name of Matthew Brainard, and this is his Twitter Twitter profile. He is the executive director of Look Ahead America. He's a former data chief and strategist for Trump for President. You can find him at matt@brainard.com. And he had this excellent video that he posted yesterday where he was describing exactly how he's going to go through this. Now, I would encourage you to go watch the video. I'm going to link it down here in the next slide. But this is a guy who has a lot of background doing this type of work. You can just tell from the way he talks and the way in the video, he actually goes through his credentials. Been doing it a long time. Definitely knows what he's talking about. Plugged in with all of the data providers around the country. Knows how to get this stuff done. So if you go watch his video, he'll take 25, 30 minutes to explain the process. I want to give you just a crash course in it because I think it's going to be pertinent for the remainder of the program and what we're talking about. So this is how he says that the Republicans are actually going to be challenging the election. This is a slide from his video where he's talking about this. We see this flow chart right here. And he starts at the top and he says, up at the top, we have what's called the absentee ballot request. They come directly from the state. So all of the requests, the early voting and the absentee ballots are all going to be requested from the state government, right? The person has to go and ask for it. Once they do that, then it's going to be sort of cross-referenced. The data is going to be checked with other data providers. So what they're going to do is they're going to get that person's name, and they're going to then enhance the data with their date of birth, their phone, the national change of address form, and the potential for them, whether they're alive or dead. So they're going to get very basic information, and then they're going to add some meat around the bones. With the date of birth, the phone, whether there was a national change of address. Every time you move, you change your address, or you should. There's a database for that, and there's also a death database. So they're taking all of this data, and if that person received a request or submitted a request, then they're going to see what happened with that. Did they return it? If they did return it, we go down this branch, and they're going to be splitting this, anybody who requested a ballot and returned it, they're going to be splitting those into three different buckets. The national change of address bucket, which is going to be trying to identify voters who no longer live at within the state. So if somebody was living in, let's say, Nevada, and then they moved to California, well, their name would show up here on the national change of address form if they changed their address with the U.S. Postal Service. So now we know that that person has moved and potentially is in the bucket where maybe they voted in Nevada, but they're living in California. And so you could identify that. Then they're going to be passing it off to the legal team to say if they were actually living out of state and they voted in that state, do they meet the residency requirement to even vote in the state? And if not, then they're going to check into the other aspects here, whether that person was deceased. And this is another high priority branch over here. So we have the national change of address. We have people who are dead, high priority here in large part because he said it's cheaper to get this data. And, if somebody's dead, of course, and they're voting, you can identify that as an illegitimate ballot. Same in this branch down here. If somebody's living in California, but they voted in Nevada, you're going to want to invalidate that. Over here, we have lower priority stuff that they're going to be sort of diving through. if there is, you know, enough funds and enough time in order to identify these people. But we also have a different branch up here where they're saying if somebody requested a mail-in ballot, an early voting, an absentee ballot, and that vote didn't come back, the question is going to be why. Why did that question or why did that ballot not come back? Did you request it? If no, well, then somebody else probably requested it. If you return the ballot, if you sent it back in, but it didn't go back to the board of elections, why not, right? And those are the types of people that they want to get an affidavit from. And so basically these two buckets down here, the affidavit form and the research team form, whether there's death certificates, these two buckets, the affidavit for people who requested a ballot or returned it or didn't return it, and the people who are dead and the people who are voting while living out of state, those are going to be the three different buckets, and those are going to be where the Republicans are focusing their efforts. They want to identify those people, get written affidavits, get death certificates, or get, you know, change of address forms that show that they don't need to vote in that state. They shouldn't have been voting there because their residency exists in a different state. So that's, you can see there, right? That's a lot of people to identify. If we're talking about 300,000 people to go through Excel spreadsheets and voter registration lists and identify all of those people is a tall order. And so they've got their work cut out for them. Now you can go check that video out before I move on. That link is down there at the bottom. YouTube is where it's at. And he's, you know, the long and short of this thing is he's explaining that they need these two items, affidavits and death certificates. Those are what they're really looking for. So we're going to talk a little bit more about some of these registries here in a little bit, but here is what Matthew Brainard has come up with thus far. So as of late last night, he was indicating here that in Nevada, they have 27,000 plus national change of address voter names who requested early voting or absentee voters in Michigan. I'm looking at MI and WI down here. We got Michigan that has 51,000 that are national change of address early voter forms. 218,000 of those were unreturned absentees. So they got mailed out, but they didn't come back. These dead buckets are looking pretty empty, right? Which is good. We don't want a lot of dead people anywhere. And if this is what they're hanging their hat on, 41 voters, 9 voters, 7 dead voters, those aren't going to qualify. Those aren't going to do anything. But we've got 36,000 in Wisconsin, 179,000 unreturned absentees. So those are interesting numbers. Those are big numbers. Those are the types of numbers that Republicans are looking for. He had another update. He said 3 concurrent call centers are now dialing the different lists, the national change of address forms, additional Trump people joining in. We've got, you know, different voters, national change of address form voters who deny casting ballots in both Georgia and Pennsylvania have been identified. And he says that the headquarter team is growing. This is a link down there if you want to send some money over to them or check out his Twitter account, because I know he has updated links and updated information on how to support their cause if you are inclined to do that. Now, I think this is great. I think this is awesome that people are really banding together to try to validate the election. Don't we want that on both sides? Don't we want the Democrats and the Republicans to be doing this? And quite frankly, it's a little bit surprising to me that a lot of the Democrats aren't doing this. There are some other states that the Democrats lost just barely, right? Just narrowly. If they were doing this, if they were also validating the results, or if they were claiming that there was fraud going the other direction, they may be able to pick up some states, right? They may be able to pick up states in North Carolina or other parts of the country where they just barely lost. And so you'd imagine that, you know, they'd be doing that, but I have not seen any evidence of that. If anybody has, I would certainly love to see that. And so that's what the Republicans are doing outside of the administration. Inside the administration, there are some things happening. As we saw yesterday on November 9th, we have an order here. It's actually a memorandum for the United States Attorney's Office from the Department of Justice, the Office of the Attorney General. This is from Bill Barr, and you can see here that he drafted this memorandum, he signed it, and he's going to go through it and modify the Justice Department policy here a little bit. Or he's actually not going to modify the policy. He's just going to, I would say, explain it, explain how it should be used. So here's what he says. Last week, our nation voted, 140 million Americans. I want to thank you all. Great, you know, confidence and safety and all that stuff. Now that the voting has concluded, it's imperative the American people can trust it in a way that won't, you know, that we want to make sure the election is the election. Although the states have primary, this is important, although the states have the primary responsibility to conduct and supervise elections under our Constitution, the U.S. Department of Justice has an obligation to ensure that federal elections are conducted in such a way that the American people can have full confidence in their electoral process and their government. And this is going to be an issue that I think is boiling over for a while, right? And this kind of cuts both ways. Largely, I think a lot of people who are running the local elections, they're going to say that the federal government should stay out of it. They should run their elections. The Constitution says they should run their elections. And when the federal government starts to interfere with state business, that's a problem. And I tend to agree with that a lot. But what Bill Barr is saying here is that, yeah, that's true. But if the states are undermining the United States Constitution, then the U.S. Constitution is going to supersede any of the other stuff that the state is doing. It's called the Supremacy Clause. When our Constitution was written, when our nation was being born, we were debating between the role of the federal government and the state government and all of the different complexities that were involved back in the 1700s with the interaction between all of the different parties. There was a big group of people who wanted big government, and there was another group of people who wanted small government, the Federalists and the Anti-Federalists. And it was a big debate. And so what they decided, the courts and you know, all the different parties through the years have decided that the U.S. Constitution reigns supreme. It's actually a clause in there that says it supersedes all of the other stuff going on around the country and in the various states. So if the U.S. Department of Justice is seeing something the states are doing that are undermining the U.S. Constitution, they've got a duty to act. And that's what Bill Barr is saying here. He goes on. And he says the department's general policies with regard to election fraud are contained in the Justice Manual. So this is sort of written in a little bit of legalese, so we'll kind of breeze through it and I'll explain it. He says in the Justice Department, we have a Justice Manual. That's where our policies are. These policies require, among other things, that we consult with a branch of the Justice Department called the ECB, which is the Elections Crimes Branch. He says, in some instances, those policies already allow preliminary inquiries, including witness interviews, to be conducted without consultation with the ECB. So in other words, there is a policy in place in the Justice Department. The policies require that we go and consult with the Elections Crime Branch, and those policies also already allow us to go and interview people. He goes on, he says, in instances in which they are consulted, so when you do go and talk to the ECB, the general practice has been from the ECB to counsel that overt investigative steps ordinarily should not be taken until the election in question has been concluded, its results certified, and all recounts and election contests concluded. Okay, so right there, right, you take a look at that. If that's the policy, if that's the Justice Department policy, that is what the Election Crime Branch would communicate back over to anybody in the DOJ, then you would read that and you say, okay, we can't investigate this. Okay, the results have not been concluded. The election has not been certified. It's still pending. But that leaves a lot of room for a huge, huge problem. And Bill Barr mentions that. He says such a delayed and passive enforcement approach can result in situations in which election misconduct cannot realistically be rectified. That's exactly right. It would be too late. Moreover, this practice, he says, has never really been a hard and fast rule anyways. Case-specific determinations and judgments must be made. So even though in long-standing form they have been following this practice, it's not really a hard and fast rule, so we're going to make case-specific judgments on it. While most allegations of election misconduct are of such a scale that they would not impact the outcome of an election, and the investigation can be appropriately deferred, that is not always the case. So he's saying sometimes when we investigate these things, it wouldn't change the outcome anyways. And if it wouldn't change the outcome, then who cares? We'll just defer it until after the election. But that may not be happening here. Furthermore, any concerns that actions could inadvertently impact the election are greatly minimized once the voting has concluded, which it has, or it will actually, in North Carolina on Thursday. I think it's on the 12th. Even if election certification has not been completed. So here he's saying, we know what the rule was. The rule is improper. The rule's not so good because if we don't investigate this stuff, we may have the result of a fraudulent election. We got to get involved in this now. We cannot wait anymore. And he's saying, essentially right now, the election has concluded. Most of the voting has stopped. Now is a good time to go and start the investigations. He goes on. He says, given this, I authorize you to pursue, and here is where the change in the policy is taking place. I authorize you to pursue substantial allegations of voting and vote tabulation irregularities prior to the certification of the elections in your jurisdictions in certain cases, as I have already done in specific instances. Okay, so that's interesting. They're now authorized to go sort of monitor their different jurisdictions so they can go do investigations there, but he's already authorized it in specific instances. So this is a general policy that is now being disseminated to the public and to the entire Department of Justice. But previously, he says that he had already authorized stuff in specific instances. I'd be very curious to see what that is about. He says, such inquiries and reviews may be conducted if there are clear and apparently credible allegations of irregularities that, if true, could potentially impact the outcome of the federal election in an individual state. Okay, this is a very high standard. Let's read that once again, because this is not like anything you find is going to be relevant. He says, such inquiries may be conducted if there are clear and apparently credible allegations of irregularities, which is actually a pretty low standard, right? Allegations of irregularities are kind of everywhere now. And if true, this is where another key point is. If it's true, it could potentially impact the outcome, all right? Now, that is a tall order. If you find some irregularities that impact 1,000 votes, that's not going to impact the election in any way. Now, just based on the numbers that we showed you previously, it's a big deal. It may be indicative of more. Okay, if you find 1,000 votes that were, you know, fraudulently tabulated, or the machine flipped the numbers, or whatever happened, it may show you and cue you in that there are other things that we need to dive in on. But it's a tall order. They got to go find something that is two things: clear and apparently credible, and could impact the outcome of the election. If either one of those two things is not relevant, according to Attorney General Barr's memorandum, they should not be investigating those cases. He says, he goes on, any investigation or claims of irregularities, if true, that would not clearly impact the outcome in an individual state should normally be deferred until after the election certification process is completed. So if it's not consequential, don't investigate it until the end of the election. While U.S. attorneys maintain their inherent authority, it will likely be prudent to start this as a preliminary inquiry. Then we're going to decide whether more information is warranted. So it's just, hey, you know, start poking around, take a look at this stuff. If it meets those two criteria, then we'll start with a preliminary investigation. We'll start doing some basic stuff. And if we need to add more resources or move teams around or do anything else in order to help the investigation move forward, we'll do those things according to the further investigative steps that are necessary. Now, he closes out the letter with this, you know, this idea that this needs to be fair, this needs to be timely, this needs to be nonpartisan and neutral. And here it is briefly. This is the last page. He says, it's imperative that credible allegations be addressed in a timely and effective manner. It is also equally imperative that we do this with fairness, neutrality, and nonpartisanship. You are some of the most important people in the Justice Department. While serious allegations should be handled with great care, anything that is specious, speculative, fanciful, or far-fetched claims should not be a basis for initiating federal inquiries. Nothing here should be taken as any indication that the department has concluded that voting irregularities have impacted the outcome. I just provide this authority and guidance to emphasize the need to timely and appropriately address the allegations of voting irregularities so that all of the American people, regardless of their preferred candidate, have full confidence in the results of the elections. The American people and leaders they freely elect deserve nothing less. So how can you have any issues with that, right? You know, here they're asking for just a sort of a preliminary inquiry into a lot of these things. I don't have any issues with that. If a different president was doing this, I wouldn't have any issues with that, because there's enough there. There's enough smoke there. We've covered it for the last several days on this channel. All right. Now, that's what Attorney General Barr is doing in his Department of Justice. But yesterday, there was also a pretty serious lawsuit that was filed by the Donald Trump campaign. We're going to go through some of the highlights there. And I wanted to just sort of preface this. This was filed in the District Court of Pennsylvania. And it's sort of the first step, right? You have district courts, you have circuit courts, and then you have the Supreme Court. There are already dozens of different lawsuits that are already at the top in front of the Supreme Court. We've covered them, a lot of them before the election. We were talking about each and all of these lawsuits in the pre-election season. And now a lot of those are sort of matriculating and percolating up. And the Supreme Court is, they're knocking at the door. And we saw that last week on Friday, Judge Alito actually issued an order to the Pennsylvania people saying, you guys are doing things wrong. You need to start, you know, segregating your ballots and keeping counts and all of that stuff. And this is a separate lawsuit. So this is a new lawsuit that's filed from the Trump administration. All of the stuff was preceding the election. It was about moving election dates. A lot of them were filed by the retired Alliance of America people, and we covered that yesterday. But now this is Donald Trump saying, okay, the election day is over. We have seen a lot of different stuff from around the country, and in particular in Pennsylvania, and we're just going to take everything, we're going to put it in this massive complaint that's 85 pages long, and then at the end of the document, there's all these different certifications, they're called certificates of service and different forms that are required in order to be part of the submission. But my point is, there's 85 pages of legalese and allegations and claims that are taking place in this lawsuit. It's massive. And there are some highlights. People have been reading the highlights and kind of posting them. And so I want to share some of them with you. Now, just a kind of a refresher on how these things work. You have to complain about something. You have to state what the basis is for the lawsuit, for the claim. You have to state what you want in terms of relief. And then you have to detail some facts. This is why the law says we are entitled to relief. These are the facts where the law was violated, and this is what we want. And so a lot of what we're going to be talking about here are some of those specific allegations of the facts. What is actually, what is the Trump campaign actually claiming took place here? And this is from Section B. This is from page 48. It says here that the misadministration of election by the county election boards and poll workers. So this is a whole section here, but the first part here under number 117 says, in Montgomery County, a poll watcher observed a judge of elections pull aside voters who were not listed in the polls as registered in the poll books as registered to vote. The poll watcher reports hearing the judge of elections tell the voters that they needed to return later and report their name as another name that was in the poll book. Okay, so that's not good. You can't have people falsifying their names. This comes from paragraph 118. Across numerous counties, poll watchers observed poll workers mishandling spoiled mail-in or absentee ballots brought to the polling place by the voters who intended to vote in person. So remember, right, you can bring in your ballots to go vote rather than disposing of the spoiled ballot. So let's pause on this, right? So let's say, for example, you requested an absentee ballot or a mail-in ballot. They send you a ballot, you say you lost it or you have it, but now you want to go vote in person. Maybe you screwed up your ballot, maybe you overvoted or undervoted or something, or got ripped or whatever it is. You just don't want to use it. You want to go in and go vote in person, and you bring your ballot with you. What they're saying is that's a spoiled ballot, right? You don't get two ballots. You don't get to go in there and pick up a different one. You're going to have a bunch of ballots that just aren't legitimate. They're spoiled for some reason or another, and that's what they're talking about here. They're saying rather than disposing of the spoiled ballots securely, the spoiled ballots were instead placed inside in unsecured boxes or in stacks of paper despite the protests of voters or poll watchers, because anybody can grab those. They're still valid ballots. For instance, in the Center County, a poll worker observed mail-in ballots being improperly spoiled. So they're actually taking ballots that were not spoiled and then spoiling them. The workers placed the mail-in ballots returned to the polling place by in-person voters in a bag without writing void on them or otherwise destroying them. So they're just taking ballots that belong to people that are legitimate, authentic ballots, saying these are spoiled, but they're not going through the spoliation process. They're not actually spoiling them. They're not actually writing void on them. They're putting them in an unsecured bag. Any single person could pick those up and just shove them right in the machine, and it's going to be counted like any other ballot, is what this is claiming. The lawsuit goes on, and it says here in paragraph 119, in at least one case, a voter brought the voter's own secrecy envelope to the polling place after realizing that the voter had failed to include it when returning the mail-in ballot. The voter was not permitted to submit a provisional ballot in accordance with the statute. So that person got disenfranchised. That person didn't get to vote. They brought they know that they screwed up their mail-in ballot. They sent it back. They came in to go vote. What they're supposed to do, according to the statute, is give you a provisional ballot. So they're going to say, look, we want your vote to count. Here's a provisional ballot. Fill this out. We're going to go through our records. If we find your other ballot, the one that you sent in that we can't count, great. We're going to get rid of that one, and we'll take your provisional ballot and we'll enter that on the record. If we do find the other one and we want to count it, right? Let's say it wasn't spoiled. That one has already been counted. Oh, we saw that it didn't have a secrecy envelope. No problem. We counted it anyways. Then that provisional ballot is not going to count. You don't get to double vote. The problem here is that this person didn't get to vote at all, but in some situations, if the reverse of that happens, somebody can mail in a ballot and then come get a provisional and then put that one in also, right, if that check is not taking place. So in paragraph 120, we see here in Allegheny County, plaintiffs have received reports that poll workers, were observing voters vote provisionally in such a way that the poll worker could not determine which candidates the elector voted for on the provisional ballot. And then they go on and say that a poll worker reported that persons appearing at the polls and admitting that they were New Jersey voters rather than Pennsylvania voters were nonetheless provided provisional ballots on which to vote. So people from literally out of state are being given provisional ballots on which to vote. Now, that's just a claim, right? We don't know if those votes counted. What if somebody from New Jersey came over, they got a provisional ballot, they fill out the provisional ballot, and that ballot goes over and they look at it and they say, no, this one is from a New Jersey resident. That shouldn't be counted, right? But the preceding paragraph, this is where this all sort of kind of is one totality of circumstances thing. Somebody who comes in who lives there and who wants to rectify their secret ballot is turned away. They're not given a provisional, but the people who come in from New Jersey, they are given a provisional. So very weird standards, very sort of asymmetric rules that are in place that this complaint is saying that, you know, may have been taken advantage of in order to modify some of the vote counts. We'll keep going on the complaint for a little bit further before we change gears. Here in paragraph 122 in Chester County, we have another one. A representative watcher present during the pre-canvass observed that the election workers counted a reported 15% of mail-in ballots that were sliced or otherwise damaged during the mechanized ballot opening process. Some of these ballots were cut in half by workers and had a hard time identifying how to address or rectify the issue. In Chester County, an observer witnessed a flawed resolution process for overvoted and undervoted ballots. So overvoted would be like if you voted for both Donald Trump and Joe Biden. You can't do that, right? You get one vote for one guy. You don't get to do double dipping on that. Undervoted would be like you only voted for president and you didn't vote for, in Arizona we have, you know, vote for three or more. If you undervoted, then you didn't vote for all three. You only voted for one, right? So that's an undervote. And here in Chester County, we see that an observer witnessed a flawed resolution process for those types of ballots. The observer witnessed one election worker responsible for resolving these by subjectively determining who the elector intended to choose on the empty votes. So they just picked. If they were empty, they just picked whoever they wanted. The observer reports that numerous instances, the election worker altered the overvoted ballot by changing the votes that had been marked for Donald Trump to another candidate. So that would be like if somebody came in and voted for Joe Biden and for Donald Trump, they would just say, okay, we're going to redo this ballot and we're only going to give it to Joe Biden. Donald Trump's vote goes away. So it's subjective, right? In a situation like that, do you want to give the poll workers the authority to just make a decision? Well, this one looks like, you know, this person also voted Democrat down here and over here, or this person has a last name that rhymes with something. Therefore, I think that person's a Democrat and we're just going to give this one to Joe Biden, right? You don't want those subjective standards. That is a huge problem. The Supreme Court has already hinted that way, that you know, if this stuff is very subjective, it's open to misinterpretation and to uneven standards, because, you know, this is supposed to be an equal election, right? Everybody's vote's supposed to count. And if somebody is throwing out votes because they don't like the name of the person on the ballot, that's a big problem. And I think that this is going to, you know, stuff like this may carry some weight as it proceeds through the courts. We have a couple other last things from the Trump lawsuit. I told you it's 85 pages. There's a lot here. It says, in Delaware County, an observer at the county office observed issues related to mail-in votes being scanned through machines four or five times before finally being counted. When a voting machine warehouse supervisor arrived to address it, they said that the ballots must be defective. The barcodes on the ballots must be defective. That's weird, right? In Delaware, poll watchers observed at least seven different polling locations, numerous instances of voters who were told they had registered to vote by mail, but were given regular ballots rather than provisional ballots and were not made to sign the registration books. Okay, again, that's a double dip. If somebody requested a mail-in ballot, that's their ballot. If they don't have it and they show up at a polling place and they're given a regular ballot again, now they have two ballots. And that is a problem. And these people were not made to sign the registration book to identify those voters so that they could pull one of the ballots out. So you got some people here allegedly double dipping. Last page before we change gears. This is paragraph 126. Mail carriers have noted a significant anomaly related to the delivery of mail ballots. A mail carrier from USPS, which we're going to talk about here today, some weird shenanigans going on in Erie County, has noted that during the course of the general election, mail-in ballot delivery period were multiple instances in which dozens of mail-in ballots were addressed to a single address, each ballot being in a different name. So one residence multiple mail-in ballots going there, all with different names. Based on the carrier's experience delivering mail, the carrier is aware that the people whose names were on the ballots are not the names of the people who live there, right? So the mail guy goes there every day. He knows who the names are. He knows who lives there. He knows what is legitimate and what isn't legitimate. In addition, ballots were mailed to vacant homes, vacation homes, empty lots, and to addresses that do not exist. It has been reported in paragraph 127 by Project Veritas, and we're going to watch their clip here next, in a release on November 5th, 2020, that carriers were told to collect, separate, and deliver all mail-in ballots directly to the supervisor. In addition, plaintiffs have information that the purpose was for the process was for the supervisor to hand stamp the mail-in ballots. Right, we're going to talk about backdating here. Now, this gentleman goes by the name of Richard Hopkins, and we have a clip here from Project Veritas. We played this clip, I think it was probably on November 5th when it first was released. We're going to play it again so you can see exactly what happened here. And it's actually a little bit, you know, when we first played this, this was all sort of speculative, right? This was just a conversation taking place. And then shortly thereafter, this guy actually drafted an affidavit that was going to be filed with the court. And now, you know, some of that stuff is changing literally today. So let's just rewind the clock a little bit. What is this U.S. Postal Service gentleman by the name of Richard Hopkins? What does he have to say? Let's watch.
Contacted you today in Pennsylvania?
Yes.
What did they say to you?
They asked me the same questions you asked me yesterday about what I'd seen and what I'd heard, and we're asking if I had any more information or whatnot.
You witnessed your supervisor backdating a ballot to November 3rd?
I did not witness them backdating it. I witnessed them talking about backdating.
What did
you
hear
them say?
Yeah, so didn't
witness it.
They were talking about how the day before, which was the 4th, they had postdated all but one of the ballots that were picked up as the 3rd, but they had one that they made a mistake and postmarked it the 4th.
You heard Robert Weisenbacher say this to Daryl, or Daryl say it? How did you hear it?
Robert was saying it to Daryl.
Robert was saying it to Daryl.
Yes.
To they made a mistake on the ballot, and they should have backdated the November 4th ballot to November 3rd, correct?
Yes.
And you heard this, and since you did the interview with me in the shadows, what has happened to you at your employment? They were taking an action against you today?
Well, I'm not for sure, but they are bringing up stuff that happened like in the past.
So they brought up old allegations against you today that were already adjudicated, and they brought those up today?
Yes.
All right. So that is his statement, right? That's his statement to James O'Keefe previously. I think that came out on November 5th. Now, more is going on with this guy, right? So let's take a look at what this is like happening on the fly. Let's run through what James O'Keefe posted on today at 8:57 a.m. So this was this morning. He says, election fraud update. U.S. postal worker Richard Hopkins in Erie, Pennsylvania has been placed on unpaid leave for blowing the whistle on the backdating of ballots. Project Veritas has confirmed federal inspectors from the Office of the Inspector General are investigating multiple post offices in Pennsylvania. Richard Hopkins, because he's unpaid, now he's got a fundraiser going on. This was going on over at GoFundMe. It says, my name is Richard Hopkins. I currently work for the USPS in Erie, Pennsylvania. I am willing to testify under oath that 2020 presidential election ballots are being backdated to November 3rd by my supervisors. I made the difficult decision to risk everything in my life to come forward with this information of extreme wrongdoing by the post office. I am uncertain of what the future holds for me, but I felt the public had a right to know what is really going on. Your donations are going to help me in the case I am wrongfully terminated or am forced into resigning due to ostracization by my coworkers. It will help me get a new start, feel safe, help me with child support until I'm able to get settled. The post office has been threatening my employment. I am scared for myself, my family, and those closest to me. Thank you, James O'Keefe and Project Veritas, for letting me tell my story when others wouldn't. Please support me as I go forward with this battle. So it sounds like somebody who's pretty scared, right? Somebody who is on his heels a little bit. I want to get a safe place. I got child support I got to pay. I'm scared for myself. I'm scared for my family. I'm scared for those closest to me. The post office has already been threatening me. with my employment. So he's got a GoFundMe account over there. I'd encourage you to go support the man because it sounds like he's in a hurting spot, but it looks like they're not even going to be allowing him to get any money out of GoFundMe because everybody gets canceled these days. GoFundMe now says they have flagged Richard's campaign. They're not allowing withdrawals from it. So that's from James O'Keefe earlier this afternoon. And it gets even weirder than this. So here we have something breaking from the Oversight Dems. It says, breaking news. Erie, Pennsylvania, the USPS whistleblower completely recanted his allegations of a supervisor tampering with the mail-in ballots after being questioned by the investigators, according to the IG. Here are the facts. Richard Hopkins, he's a U.S. Postal Service employee. He signed a sworn affidavit with allegations of ballot tampering, fraud, and the public, and went through Project Veritas. The inspector general began investigating last week. IG investigators informed the committee staff today that they interviewed Hopkins on Friday, but that Hopkins recanted his allegations yesterday and did not explain why he signed a false affidavit. Isn't that interesting? You know, we see this all the time in criminal law. We saw it in the Breonna Taylor case. Do you remember that? Remember when the police showed up and they were looking for witnesses to support the claim that they knocked on the door, on Breonna Taylor's door, and they couldn't find anybody? They found somebody there who said, no, I didn't hear anything. And then like 3 days later or 12 days later or whatever it was, I don't remember the dates, but after they interviewed the hell out of him for a long, 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 long time, he suddenly goes, oh yeah, I remember now. I did hear you knock loud and clear. This happens all the time. We see this in criminal law everywhere, right? Police get involved. They start beating the hell out of somebody and that person changes their story a little bit. So the fact that this guy recanted is not surprising to me. There are literally millions and millions of people on the media, on the internet, all over the place who are calling people lunatics and conspiracy theorists and saying that we're bad people and we're racist and all sorts of insane things just for having a conversation about it. Just a conversation. This guy is the centerpiece of it. This guy was somebody who is on the ground level, right? My boss was the one telling us to backdate these things in violation of the law. And now I'm imagining, I have no doubt in my mind that he's getting death threats. He's getting, you know, threats from all over the country. He's probably scared to death. Now he's in a position where he's potentially losing his job. And, you know, the world is crashing down on this guy. So for him to, for people to come out and say, oh, this guy, you know, he's just a squish, he's unreliable or any of those things, you have no idea the amount of pressure that this man is under right now. And so, you know, maybe we cut him a little bit of slack on this one, right? One way or the other, I don't know. For somebody to come out and sign an affidavit and post a statement like that to say, listen, I'm scared for my life. I'm scared. I'm concerned about this thing. But I got to tell the truth anyway, to suddenly, you know, get interviewed by the government and his story flips immediately. I'd be very curious what they're threatening him with. Are they saying, we've got proof on this case and we know that you're lying. And if you're lying, we're going to charge you with, you know, false reporting, falsification of a crime, whatever, you know, federal statute they want to go after him for. And we're going to throw you in jail for 20 years unless you recant. Right. That may be what happened here. It may not be. Maybe this guy did make it all up. I don't know. But you can just give it your own analysis. OK, he did an interview. He signed a document, an affidavit, a sworn document under penalty of perjury, and even started a GoFundMe account where he's explaining how scared I am. Then he changes his story after an interview with the feds. You can come to your own conclusions on that. All right. So we have somebody who just sent in a super chat, said Richard Hopkins did not recant. James O'Keefe is going to have him on and playing interrogation tape. So is that fake news? That's in a whole nother angle in this thing. Is that fake news? Is this recanting thing fake news? It's hard to tell anymore. But from what we're able to see thus far, you know, I believe his original story. He was there. He's on the record in multiple different occasions. The only thing that potentially may have made him flip was the interview with the feds, with the inspector general. We'll follow up on that. Thank you. That super chat came from Charmed3XS saying Richard Hopkins did not recant. James O'Keefe is going to have him on and playing the interrogation tapes. Thank you, Charmed3XS. Appreciate that. All right, let's change gears a little bit. Let's go over to my beautiful home state of Arizona. We've got some new developments over here, and I want to share them with you. So Secretary Hobbs is the person who runs our elections, and Karen Fahn, the president of the Arizona State Senate, sent this letter over to her. And it's kind of a little bit hedging, I would say. But she is now basically asking for, you know, more information about what happened in the election here in Arizona. It says this election cycle has been one of the most contentious. Election campaigns, a lot of conflict, a lot of controversy. No surprise that there are serious allegations of fraud and corruption in the election. Allegations of it. It appears that these allegations will linger indefinitely, may cause substantial damage to the credibility of our democratic process if something isn't done to alleviate the claims that the election was conducted unfairly, if not fraudulently. And that's the same point I've been making here, right? This is good for everybody. This is good for the Democrats. This is good for the Republicans. If we can settle this and we can prove that there are no legitimate, serious, let's say impactful claims, no consequential fraud took place, we all want to know that. I want to know that. The Democrats should want to know that. Everybody should want to know that our elections are being run safely, securely, authentically, with good credibility. If it's being fraudulent, either way, by either party, I would think both parties and all Americans would want to know about that. She goes on. She says, to properly analyze the many claims that have been made, I believe it is imperative that you, as the chief election officer of the state, make available all data and the logic and accuracy test to independent expert evaluation. Assuming the allegations of fraud are without merit, an independent analysis would help to restore credibility and hopefully end the current controversy over fairness in the election process in Arizona. And she says here, listen, to be clear, I am not claiming that fraud was involved in Arizona's election, but many others are making that claim. I believe it is imperative that we do everything we can to satisfy Arizonans and their votes were lawfully counted and the election was completely legitimate, right? That's all we want. If the election is legitimate and it's clear that Joe Biden won, great. Where's the evidence? Let's see the evidence. Let's do our analysis. Let's give all of the information to everybody. Everybody can just go to, you know, go to town as much as their little heart desires to dissect this stuff and analyze it and hopefully come back to the table and say, yeah, look, it was all good. We had some fraud, sure. Yeah, we had some people who double voted. We had 1,000 votes here in this one state. Okay, nothing consequential, right? You would need 300,000 plus votes to be consequential. And we all just want to take a look. And that's what Karen Fawn from the president of the Arizona Senate is saying. Now, elsewhere in Arizona, Trump is continuing to close the gap here just a little bit. Donald Trump pulls within 1% of Joe Biden in Arizona. And we're going to have an automatic revote if it goes into 0.1%. Trump has 1.63 million to Joe Biden's 1.64 as of late yesterday. And the lead has slowly decreased for Joe Biden as new ballots are added to the count. Now, so Arizona has become a really, really, really close spot. And I've had some commentary about, you know, how I thought Arizona was going to go and why I'm a little bit surprised that it was so in favor of Joe Biden this go around, because I wasn't experiencing that on the ground floor. You know, I live here. I drive all over the place here. I have family all over the place. I know Arizona pretty well. I've been in high school here, college here, everything. So I know it. And what I saw this election cycle was just not, it was not a lot of support for Joe Biden. Yesterday, I made the commentary that it was pretty obvious to me that Mark Kelly was going to beat Martha McSally. That was the senator here. Obvious. We all knew that. Everybody knew it. And that's what happened. But the same sort of feeling, the same sort of gut feeling that I had about the presidential election obviously went the wrong way. And maybe that's just me. Maybe I was just off. Or maybe there's something actually going on here. And I talked about previously Benford's law on this channel. We've done a little bit of an explanation for it in the preceding shows, analyzing some of the data. But we have new data specifically about this rule, about this law, as it applies to Maricopa County here in Arizona. And the findings are very interesting. So anytime that I'm kind of, you know, looking at these new analyses by different people, I'm always asking myself, is there alternative explanations for it? Is this person credible? Is there any other, you know, way that we could come to a different conclusion based on the same facts? And previously, when we were talking about Benford's law and a lot of this sort of internet sleuthing that's going on, the counterpart to that is we don't know what the data looks like. We don't really know where the data came from. We don't know who the people are who are doing this analysis. It's just some random people on Twitter. There's another tweet we're going to get to here from a person named Gummy Bear, right? Who is that? Now, we know the data is pretty good. We know that the analysis is pretty good. It looks good. But this guy, his name is Gummy Bear. That's all we know about the guy. Now, I follow him. I think he's pretty dang brilliant, quite frankly. So I don't care what his name is. But for most people, they want to know, who is that guy? What are his credentials? Where did he go to school? And so this new analysis on the Benford's law on data from Maricopa County has somebody who's pretty dang credible who actually did the analysis. And here is who that is. His name is Mark Nigrini, And he's born in Cape Town, South Africa. He's an associate professor of accounting at the College of Business and Economics at the West Virginia University in Morgantown, the U.S. state of West Virginia. You can see some of his information here. Research interests are forensic accounting, fraud examination, forensic analytics, and data analytics. And he actually wrote the book in 2011 called Forensic Analytics. He wrote a book in 2012 called Benford's Law. And in 2020, he wrote the second edition of Forensic Analytics here, Methods and Techniques for Forensic Accounting and Investigations. And I would encourage you to watch this guy's entire video. It's very good, very well done, a little bit long, but for good reason. The link is down here. And you can just search for his name and I'm sure it'll pop up. But the reason it's long is because he goes through and he actually cleans the data up. You can see exactly what he's doing. So when he's going through, he actually downloads the data in the video from the Maricopa County website. They have a CSV file, you can comma separated values. He just downloads the file, opens it up in an Excel spreadsheet, clears out the rows, gets rid of the useless data. So he has nice working data. So it's literally from Maricopa County. Then what he does is he starts some analysis on it. And as we have seen, Benford's Law is this concept. It's an abstract concept. I'm not a mathematician, but the long and short of it is numbers exist naturally in nature in certain proportions. And you may think to yourself, okay, because there's numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and the number 0, that these numbers would just show up sort of at equal intervals across the world, right? You'd have 10% of the number 1s, 10% of the number 7s, 10% of number 8s, and so on. Doesn't really work like that. And so when I was researching some of this stuff and trying to understand how this works, one of the videos that I was watching explained you can go get a copy of the New York Times, circle every number on that newspaper, front to back, both sides, put those in a list, and they're going to all of the numbers, right? So, 200,000 dead from coronavirus. We've got, 17 countries join whatever treaty, whatever that looks like. Circle all of those numbers, put them in a list. When you sort the list and you analyze that list, the number that's the first digit in that number. So if it's, 200,000 dead, the first number there would be a 2. And you would just do that for the entirety of your data. And what Benford's Law says, and it's bizarre to me, but it works, is that the number 1 is actually going to appear about 30% of the time. So even though there's really 10 digits, the number 1 is going to be about 30% of the time. And if you think it through, it kind of makes sense. So if you count, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 8, 9, right? 1 only shows up the first digit 9 times there. But if you go to 10, now the 1 shows up again. And the 1's going to show up again for 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 7, and all the way up to 20, right? So it's going to get front-loaded a little bit until it hits 20, and then the percentages are going to even back out again. Then when you hit 100, the 1's going to be there for a long time. A lot of 1's because you got from 100 to 200, so the 1's are going to show up more frequently, and then they're going to dip back down when you hit to 200, and again to 1,000, and so on. And so what you get is this neat little curve called Benford's Law, where it says that certain numbers, if they're natural, will show up at certain intervals in a way that you may not expect. So what this guy did, Mark Nigrini, is he went through Maricopa County and he just pulled all the numbers out from all of the different precincts and all of their different voting numbers. And here's what he found. The numbers are very interesting. So Benford's Law is going to follow a typical curve, and I'll show you what it looks like. And this is the curve of what he's calling registered voters. So the number of registered voters in different counties or in different precincts throughout the state of Arizona. These bar charts are the actual data. This line here is Benford's curve. So Benford's curves, each one of these, charts here, should meet this line. They should all go up and actually be closer to this. So this is very, very, very not good data. And up here he says the mean, I think adjusted deviation or something deviation is 0.056, right? Which is very high. In other words, the standard deviation from this line, how far off are each one of these bars from this line is going to be a total of 0.056. I think it's the mean, standard deviation, whatever that MAD stands for. And he's saying it's a 0.056. So these charts, these bar graphs should be much more in alignment with this Benford's Law line. The number 1 should be showing up about 30%. The number 2 should be showing up at about 18%. Number 3 should be down here at about 13%, and so on. And so the data here, he's indicating, or he's leaning this way, saying it's not natural. It's not conforming. These bar graphs should have matched the line on Benford's law. Then he breaks down the data a bit. So now he's actually looking at Donald Trump's first digits, which is a lot more in conformity. So he goes through, he does all of the registered voters first, then he goes through and he does all of the Trump numbers. And you'll see here that Trump's numbers look like they're in a lot more conformity with Benford's law. Okay, over here, the number one is a little bit high, you know, about 8 percentage points high. Number two is pretty close. And so the deviation, the difference between where these bars are and where they're expected to be in accordance with Benford's law is a 0.024. So significantly less. You can see here, they're not that far off. They're much, much closer. When you go over to Joe Biden, this is what it looks like. So again, major deviations. So Joe Biden, the number one are up dramatically, something like 20%. Number twos are kind of right on there, but number threes, number fours, number fives, number six, everything else is off. All of these should be higher and this should be dramatically lower. The median, you know, deviation here is 0.054. And when he adds them all up, he goes through and he just says here, right here, you have a point, anything that's above a 0.015 is a non-conformity, is what he says. Okay, that's the guy who wrote the book on Benford's law. That's the guy who is a professor at a very well-respected university and has a lot of experience doing this type of stuff. He did the analysis. He went through it piece by piece. He showed you exactly how he did it. He got the data from Maricopa County elections itself. So this is about as credible as you can be on this thing. And you know, he doesn't actually give us a conclusion on it. He doesn't say, okay, well, this shows that it was clearly fraudulent and Joe Biden's a liar. He doesn't do any of that. He just says, okay, yeah, here's the data. Anything over a 0.015 is non-conforming data, and that's all there is to it. Thanks for watching. And he goes on, right? So you're free to draw your own conclusions about it. But he just did the analysis on the data. So you can take it for what it's worth. But, you know, again, this stuff is sort of a little bit different than what we were talking about at the beginning of the program, where the Republican strategists now are looking for affidavits from voters who saw something, affidavits from poll watchers, written sworn documents from the people who were there. They need that stuff. This type of stuff is super interesting, and it gives you the ability to hone in on things a little bit, you know, further, narrow it down a little bit to say, okay, yeah, there's something going on in Maricopa County because these numbers don't match. Now, on the other side of this argument, some data that I have not seen, which I would really like to see, how does this data look for 2016? How does this data look for 2018? And even further back, what did it look like in 2008 when it was Obama versus McCain here in Arizona? What'd that look like, right? We can go back and we can look at all of the different data and see, is this because of voting and Benford's law? Is this just, you know, something that it's not supposed to match up? The other argument I've heard against this Benford law analysis is that, the sample sizes are too small. You know, this should be for numbers that are many orders of magnitude. We're talking millions of numbers because you need enough randomness in order for that to work. And, I thought maybe there's some credibility to it, but this guy, the guy who wrote the book on it, the guy who's a professor, the guy who has a lot of credentials, he did it. He just pulled the numbers and he was very good at doing it. You could see he's done this probably about a million times and he knows what he's doing. And his numbers came back non-conformity. The data is non-conforming. So that's just in Arizona. There are additional things going on around the country. Some people are now saying that, now this has not been confirmed as far as I know, but this is sort of the popular right-wing conspiracy theory talk that a lot of people are saying is existing. If you're on the left, if you're on the right, you're saying this is a lot more evidence of pretty clear voter fraud. And so in Wisconsin, we've got another county another voting glitch. It looks like this was a 19,500 net vote gain. So this was taking place out of Wisconsin. This is Gummy Bear that I'm talking about. Gummy Bear over here is asking about this specifically. He says, hey, New Jersey, what happened here? Now, New Jersey is a state that Donald Trump was never expected to win. This is inconsequential, but he's saying, how does Trump in red simultaneously lose almost 80,000 votes while Biden gains almost 80,000 votes? I'm genuinely curious to understand how this works. If anybody with knowledge can tell me, let me know. So you see over here, New Jersey at 3:25 a.m. on the day after the election on November 4th, 79,568 votes go away from Donald Trump. 79,568 votes go towards Joe Biden. So interesting there, right? Now, I've seen some people responding in that tweet thread. Somebody said, well, it's just probably just a clerical error, right? They were just updating their data. Somebody's moving things around, whatever it is. But that type of stuff rings the bell for people, right? When they see massive changes in this stuff and look at the rest of the data, right? When you go through the rest of the numbers, you see here, it looks like just votes are coming in. Not a lot of subtractions here. Okay, 72 votes came in at 242 for Trump. 100 votes came in for Biden. In New Jersey, 4854 came in at 243.06. 10,000 came in for Joe Biden. So that's all pretty standard, but you don't see these massive, you know, deletions here. Actually, Joe Biden has a deletion down here in the bottom right, and Donald Trump has a gain, but they're not they're not equal, right? It's not an equal flip. In other words, Donald Trump didn't get 1342 because Joe Biden lost 1342. And so, the data is just looking weird, and people are diving into it, and they want to see if there is anything further, which I think is good. We want more certainty around this election so that at the end, whoever is ultimately the next president has legitimacy. Spent a lot of time talking about legitimacy yesterday. We need legitimacy in order for the government to work. If half the country thinks that the next president is illegitimate, that's a problem for everybody. So we want more transparency, more conversation about this, less of the talk of you're just a lunatic if you don't accept that Joe Biden is the next president. It's not particularly helpful. A lot of the people in the media want you to believe that, but it's not particularly useful. And so late last night, there was an interesting thing that took place. We've already talked about this woman named Elle before on this channel, and she cracked something late last night. It was kind of a weird thing to be a part of. We saw she posted this tweet about this thing that she was working on, and it sort of developed throughout the night. And then I woke up this morning, and there's websites about it, and there's all sorts of stuff. So she was breaking this story literally, I think, like at 10:30, 11 o'clock Arizona time last night. I woke up this morning. Now there's websites, and like there's a small team that is congregating around this concept. I mean, it's kind of amazing. I've never seen anything like it, quite like it. And so again, once again, her name is Elle, and this is from a post from her. She says, "Maidengate is what was going viral last night." And it was. Maidengate, the actual term on Twitter, was trending, I think, number 9, and then maybe up to number 1 in some places. And she says here in her post that it is a viral hashtag uncovering a peculiar type of abuse in our elections. Some married women vote in one state under their current name, while someone, a political predator, casts a vote in that same state or a state which the woman previously lived under a previous or maiden name. The same technique may affect adopted persons, divorced people, people who change their names, or transgender persons. This credit is owed to Lauren, who discovered her mother was such a victim. And Ali Alexander and other people are now verifying the same types of claims. So essentially what she's saying is that, you know, a woman can be married and then get divorced, and now she's sort of registered in different states under different names, and that might enable the person to have two ballots and two votes. And part of the revelation was that a lot of people around the country were getting text messages from people for different people and for different names. In other words, the people who were doing this voter sort of rallying, you know, to congregate voters to get them to go and vote, to engage them, they're getting these lists, and they're sending people text messages with the wrong names because they've got the wrong person, because the records are all cross-referenced, and it's all a mess. Anyways, so what she's saying here is that married women may have been who then got divorced and changed their names or didn't change their names, maybe getting duplicate ballots. And this may have led to an exposure that if somebody knew this and they knew how to exploit this, then maybe they could take advantage. And in this case, I think she's saying that Lauren discovered that her own mom was such a victim. And so, as I said, I woke up this morning and the internet was just going wild, and there was already this infographic that came out telling you how to handle this stuff. So let me go ahead and run through this with you quickly. It says, "Maidengate, did Biden really win the single ladies? Check your vote under your old name." So go and actually check to see if somebody voted in your old name. I just found out my wife voted under her maiden name here in Washington. We've been married for 9 years. So the instructions here, check your registration in any state which you've ever lived. If you can check whether a ballot was cast, even better. If you got a text from a different state asking about your vote, that's a big red flag. Check your registration status for any names that you were registered under before. Name changes due to marriage, divorce, adoption, whatever. If you're in Oakland, Maricopa County, Fulton County, Georgia, Allegheny County especially, but this seems to be nationwide. If your registration does come up, look into supermajority or any one of these other text farms that were texting people on November 3rd asking them if they were planning on voting. And then you can follow her on Twitter, and she's doing amazing work. She's got a lot of other information that you can follow here. Just a quick refresher here. If you want to take a screenshot of that, below you'll find some additional information. And she actually, you can follow her on Twitter. This is her handle here, so you can go and check her out. And she's got some detailed instructions on this stuff. And it was just kind of, it was kind of blowing up. This, you can see here last night, that it was trending, 17,000 tweets, politics, it was trending number 9. And I think it actually went further up as the night progressed. And then, you know, other people who are part of this entire investigation are now just throwing resources her way, which is very, very neat. This is Allie, says, I've independently verified that women have cast votes in own name, and another vote was cast under their maiden name. Now provided a small team to her and a channel to the Trump campaign and law enforcement tomorrow to get these victims and voters justice. So that's it for the program. We're going to jump on over to the live chat right now. And I know that I've got a couple super chats that I need to address. So I want to thank you all for being here. Let's get that chat cranking, rocking and rolling. And let me see what we have going on. All right. So super chat from Tyler Stokes. Thanks, Tyler. He says, is Joe Biden attempting to create a new federal office within the executive branch with the whole office of the president elect eager for a power grab? You know, the office of the president elect is something I don't even think exists in the U.S. government. Okay, I don't think that that is even a thing. I think it was sort of created, but I don't think that that's an actual federal agency. I just plugged it into Google and I don't see anything, right? Wikipedia talks about the presidential transition, the executive branch, what it means to be the president-elect. I think if you recall, this was something that Obama did back during his campaign, right? As soon as before he was even elected, he was doing speeches in front of presidential signs and symbols, and all the Republicans like Sean Hannity were, you know, spazzing out over it. He can't do that. He's not the president yet. And, you know, sort of this warming up of the American people that I am already president. And that we're seeing that right now with Joe Biden for sure. Seeing that all over the place. It's sort of a foregone conclusion. If you don't accept the results of this election, if you don't think that he is the next president, well, then you're some sort of a lunatic and you need to be put on a list and you need to be ostracized because you're contributing to the downfall of American democracy if you question it. So a lot of this, we talked about this yesterday, is thinking past the sale. If you just presume that Joe Biden is the next president, you don't have to worry about how he got there. Right. The American public has already decided. So who cares if half the votes are irregular? It's already a foregone conclusion. It's a good question. But I don't think the office of the president elect is actually a thing. We had a previous super chat from even before the show started. It comes from James Clark. He says, enjoying your channel. Can you tell us how Arizona is going to follow this law, Arizona Statute 16-602, and if that remedy is found in 16-602-8E, since there are no precincts but voting centers? Thanks from Eastern Time Zone. So thanks, James Clark, for that super chat. Super specific. Super chat was super specific. And I don't know the answer to that. I'm not going to be able to pull up that statute here, but I will take a look at it. I'll look at what the actual law is that you're speaking about, and then I'll look at the remedy in subsection 8E. It must be about elections, I'm going to presume, but I will take a closer look at that. Thank you for the super chat. Thanks for being here, and I will answer that, and I will see where I can post that. If I can post an answer in the Discord or on the community page on YouTube, on the YouTube channel, I will. All right, and then we had another one from Charmed, who said, once again, Richard Hopkins did not recant. James O'Keefe is going to have him on and playing the interrogation tape. All right. So let's go on over to the chat. We've got Steve Menard, who says 135 new cases today and 1400 dead. That's why Biden needs to take control now. We have another one from Animal Lover. If you use SS numbers to vote, it can be easily stolen. So must mean security, social security numbers. Watching you daily is here. He is here often now. He's watching you daily. He's watching us daily. He says, R&R Law Group, in the primaries here in Washington, someone was able to get a registration in my name in a blue county while I'm registered in a red county, and I've never lived in that county. Ooh, that's interesting. Watching you daily, you may want to send that over to somebody who's grinding through this stuff. Dan Hill says, thanks for your time and making a presentation daily, Rob. It provides faith with a lot of hand-eye coordination exercises while keeping us in line. Yeah, she's busy back there. And after the show's over, I usually go in there and see how she's doing. And She's hanging in there. She's doing well. So thanks for thinking about her. Thanks for thinking about us. Why do people keep deleting their comments? It's probably because it's, you know, a little spammy or maybe a little bit not relevant, but we got some moderators who are taking control of that. Ma the Fox and Miss Faith are doing a great job. At R&R Law Group, I was able to catch it and get that registration terminated and the ballot terminated. That's from watching you daily. Nice job on that. Yeah, you should get one vote. All right. Social Crusader says, no one becomes president until they are officially sworn in. Our votes are only suggestions. We do not live in a true democracy. Electoral College trumps our vote. No official president until January. That's true. And if, in fact, the Electors Day is on December 14th. And so a lot of this stuff, we're actually going to get, it may not take all the way up until the 14th. There is a safe harbor provision in the law that says that some of this stuff can be dealt with before the 14th. In other words, the Trump campaign may start taking action on, depending on how this all unfolds over the next coming weeks, we're going to know a lot more. So we all just need to kind of, hold on a little bit, because right now everybody wants answers, but it's too early. Keep that in mind. There's a lot of game left to play. All right. The pool pros, I used to clean pools. Where did that one go? I used to clean swimming pools when I was in high school and when I was in college. He says, I got a piece of mail that says I voted the last two elections and I actually have not voted. Yeah, that's interesting. I'm sorry. I don't believe Biden got more votes than Obama, especially with the overvoting we know about. That comes from Ryan. Ryan H. is in the house. We have Hugh McDonald who says, is there any way to speed up chat? I can only post like once a minute. So I think, Hugh, I think that's intentional, right? It's so much information. So if we unload, I think it's called slow mode. If we turn it on regular mode, it's just chaos in the comments. And so we want people to think about, make the comment count, because you only get one every so often. And then that way it keeps the chat a little bit more productive. Elias is here. He's here frequently. Good to see you again, my friend. He says, do you think the chances of fraud look more likely today compared to yesterday? Do you think the chances of fraud look more likely today compared to yesterday? Yeah, I do. So I think every day we're going to continue to see this. Yesterday we talked about the scale of legitimacy, and the scale of legitimacy right now is really leaning towards, I would say, was leaning towards the Democrats pretty considerably. Everybody was dogpiling on this thing that Joe Biden's going to be the next president. As this continues to trickle out, as new affidavits come out, as new, signed documents, lawsuits, as court rulings start coming, down the pike, as attorney generals we're starting to see are now, actually going on the record saying, I support audits. We're seeing that around the country. We're seeing different legislatures around the country. Many of them are controlled by the GOP. They're starting to speak up and say, yeah, we're going to need to do an audit on this thing. So every single day, that scale is going to slowly start tipping back, I think, towards Donald Trump. Now, we're not there yet, and there's still a long way to go, but I think if that keeps tipping this way, and the media and the many people in the establishment who want to just keep telling us to stop talking about it, if they don't wake up a little bit and start refuting the claims, then they're going to lose a lot of their legitimacy, because the actual law is going to start coming into effect, right? There is no law that supports them right now. The law that supports the election is the law that's already written in the election code. And we have more answers in that on December 7th and December 14th. But at this point in time, it's just claims. It's just what they say. And that's not evidence. That's not law. So I think that the scale is going to tip back towards the Trump campaign when more evidence comes out. And there certainly will be. The other point on that is, why are the Democrats, at least that I have seen, not refuting some of these key claims? We went through Benford's law. There was somebody who had a lot of high credibility who is actually making videos showing you where he gets the data and how he does his analysis. Where are the people on the other side of the aisle who say that is fraudulent, that is false, that's not accurate? Where are the data analysts from the Democratic Party coming out and saying, no, I ran the same analysis. Benford law is garbage. Here's why it's garbage. X, Y, and Z. Where is that? I have not seen it. Thus far, it has all been mostly, Trump and the people who are in his camp doing this digging, just going in and just scraping this data and putting it all together. And they seem to be winning, I would say, the informational war on the ground level. The media and what you see on the headlines and what you see from these big influencers and everybody accepting it, that's just surface level stuff. That stuff is very fluid. That stuff can come and go. If there's big evidence of fraud, manipulation, or voter electoral fraud or whatever it is, that can tip that scale dramatically, because this is the side of legitimacy that, you know, was a part of the scale that we talked about yesterday. That's all just mostly facade stuff. It has no strong foundation. And if Donald Trump and his team, if they come up with some serious meat, some substantive red meat, that may tip the scale back the other way. Zulu says Trump also got more votes than Obama. I think he did. Yeah, I think he did. Now, there's more voters than there were. And, you know, there's more people voting by mail. So, you know, I think these massive vote numbers from for both Donald Trump and Joe Biden, like, they're going to be high because people are voting by mail a lot more. All right. Some guy says, if part of the country succeeds, are you going red or blue? I'm going to the one that has no income tax. Wherever that one is, that's where I'm going. All right. Amanda W. says, cheaters aren't smarter than mathematicians. LOL. I would agree with that. We have USA Libertarian who says confidence game. Brad Claxton says Fox is dead to me. How do you feel about Fox now compared to before the election? Tucker is still cool. So Brad, you know, I actually canceled cable a long time ago, and including Fox News, I just don't watch it. I do like watching some of the clips of Tucker, but it's very, all of the news to me is just hyper repetitive. It's the same talking points. I could turn on Sean Hannity. I could turn on Rachel Maddow, and I could basically do the show for them because I have heard the same talking points from each of them for the last 10 years. So it's not that interesting. I actually prefer to get my news from other, I would call them more alternative media, people who are more critical thinkers. And I like formats where you can have a lot more of an in-depth conversation like this, where I can just, you know, talk and kind of share how we process things in our minds together in a long period of time, not something that's highly structured, highly templated in a rigorous format that just doesn't enable you to pause and think a little bit. We have Zulu, who's asking a question, I think, of Faith. He says, hi, Faith. Is there anything outside of a Trump victory that would convince you that the election result is valid? If so, what? So I think that question is for Miss Faith, but I will take a stab at it. So I would love to see more data about it. I mean, truthfully, I would like to get other expert opinions about this data. And if the people that I had spoken about, like Brayford and some of these other individuals, if they bring up claims of voter fraud and they don't file a lawsuit that has the evidence backing the lawsuit, then I will not believe them. Okay, if the documents that they're going to bring into the court or bring in front of the Supreme Court or whatever, whoever's hearing the claims, if the evidence there is weak, then the lawsuits should be thrown out. Right? Just because Trump is unhappy that he lost the election doesn't mean he's entitled to be president again. But there seems to be right now enough to at least take a closer look. And so that's all we're asking for. If the closer look has been completed and people go through it and they say, yeah, Benford's law doesn't matter because X, Y, and Z, and we did a full audit of the election and nothing took place, at some point, yeah, I would agree, everybody needs to accept that. And there may be a significant portion, to Zulu, to your point, there may be a portion of, you know, the Trump people who will never accept it. That's not me personally. If we can just take a little bit closer look on this thing, and I just want to see where these lawsuits go. Essentially, I want to see what the evidence is. What do the affidavits look like? Is there really fire here? We can smell a little bit of smoke, but is it hot? Is it burning? And so, in my mind, I'm a due process guy. I like the process to be followed. The process is in place here. This is not, you know, the situation of the century. This is an election, and there are legal challenges that take place during elections, and we can figure this out as a country. This isn't, you know, the country is not melting down because we have lawyers going into battle against each other. I think iron sharpens iron, and if both sides are going to go in and hash and duke this thing out, I think this is the biggest legal battle in the history of the world, truly taking place right now in front of our very eyes, which is a very wild time to be an attorney, and it's an interesting thing to be a part of, which is why it's so exciting to follow it. Now, if the Republicans bring their claims into court and the Democrats refute their claims, great, and the courts settle it, fine with that, and that will be enough for me. And I'll consider Joe Biden to be the next president, and I'll be happy with that. If the December 14th comes and goes and all of the different states certify Joe Biden is the next president, great. Now we transition. Now we want to hold Joe Biden accountable. Now we want to get back to watching the watchers and criminal justice reform and holding our elected officials accountable. But we'll see if we get there. All right, that one time at has a super chat. He says, what about poll watchers not allowed in even after presented with court order? Is that alone enough to not, to have a revote? We can never verify the vote. So that's a great question. Yeah. And I think this is that question comes from that one time at. I think it's a great question. And I think this is going to be what happens throughout the country, that a lot of these issues are going to be settled in lower level courts. And until they get to the higher level courts, we're not going to know the answer to those questions, unfortunately. It's something that is going to be a matter of law that the higher level courts will decide. And the fact that some people didn't go in and watch the votes being, you know, counted, I don't think that that is enough, quite frankly, to overturn an election. Just because they didn't get to go in and see it, that is not enough in my mind to say we're going to throw out the results of the election. Now, that plus some other things might be enough, right? If you go through and you subpoena some records and you see that there's some collusion going on between these election officials, if you say, okay, everybody in this one tabulation center was colluding to keep the Republicans out of the building, that's a whole separate ballgame. Now you've got malfeasance. You've got active malfeasance by the county board of elections. You've got some evidence saying that they intended to manipulate the vote. But just because the Republicans are outside of the building complaining, well, we can't see what they're doing, I mean, it's kind of a weak claim. Now, I understand why they made the claim. It's necessary. That type of claim is necessary in order to continue with other claims. They need to say, we weren't able to go gather the evidence. In other words, they don't have enough evidence to file a significant complaint, or they didn't on November 4th, on November 5th. They didn't have enough information yet. So they had to put a stake in the ground and say, we don't have access to the information we need. File a lawsuit. Then when the judge says, okay, now let's think about it, that gives the Republicans time to then go draft more lawsuits, gather more evidence, and file a more substantive complaint, which is exactly what we saw Donald Trump's team do yesterday. And that's the complaint that we went through here. So just the claim alone that we didn't get to see what was going on, I don't think it's enough. I think it's pretty weak, but it's necessary. And it leads to more strong claims further down the road. All right, we have Amanda Solo, who says, I can't believe that Americans are so brainwashed that if they're willing to give up their rights, if Biden won, okay, but the facts are that all the irregularities were in his favor. Weird. Yeah. And I think a lot of people are going that route. JR is in the house. He's saying, guys, you just need to accept Trump lost. That's from JR. We have Wyatt S says, we picked up several seats in the House and are retaining the Senate. A Biden presidency won't be as damaging as people think. I agree with that. Yeah, I mean, I think Joe Biden is mostly just a figurehead at this point. You know, we know what the Democratic Party wants to do. Nothing is a surprise, you know. And is America going to crumble as a result of a Democrat in the White House by the name of Joe Biden, who's already been around the federal government and local government for 47 years? He's a pretty much a known quantity, right? We know that he's Joe Biden. We kind of know everything about the guy. So is he going to end America as we know it? I don't think so. Is Donald Trump going to end America as we know it? No, of course not, right? So everybody can just, I think, turn back down the dial a little bit on the hysteric mode panel. We have another super chat coming in from Donald McSivillin, who says, what happens if a state can't be certified due to the lack of full and complete legal ballots being kept record of? So the pressure release valve on these elections is the Electoral College and its state legislatures. So the state legislature, they're the ones who govern the elections, and you can look it up in the Constitution. It's there, right? So if, you know, the voting that takes place is just a nice thing that we do as Americans. We vote, and the vote is supposed to influence the electors who then vote in the Electoral College. But the vote, it doesn't even need to take place, really, right? The state legislatures can bypass the vote. That's what the whole purpose of the Electoral College is. So if the state legislatures, if at the safe harbor deadline in December, around December 7th, I think it is, if there's all these lawsuits, if everything is still going on, if we can't come to a conclusion on who the next president is, the Trump campaign can go to all of the different state legislatures, which I think are the majority now in the country. The majority of them are GOP, at least in the battleground states, and say, we want you to throw out the vote. We don't even want you to include or even consider the vote. The whole election was fraudulent. We know the judges aren't going to throw the election out. We know that the state's not going to redo the election. So we're just asking the legislature and your electoral votes to go for Trump. We say that this is the pressure release valve. We can't really identify that there was fraud. We have enough evidence of it. The courts aren't doing anything about it. But now we're going to ask you to hand the presidency back over to Donald Trump. That would be a huge, huge deal. And I think that the legitimacy issue that I've been talking about for a long time, I think would basically be non-existent if that happened for the Donald Trump campaign. But he would be president again. So it's just another thing that another technique that he can do to win at the very end. And it's a good question by Donald. We have Dorothy says, doesn't matter what political party you are voting for, what is at stake here is the elections being viewed as valid in the future. That's exactly right. Yeah, we want to make sure that they're being that the election is valid. And this is in the interest of both parties. Okay, just because we're here talking about Donald Trump doing it doesn't necessarily mean that the Democrats shouldn't also be doing it. I would encourage them to do it. Why are they not auditing the election? Why are they not combing through these records? Is it because they won? Right? We want a clear election. We want to be confident in it. And so I understand the Democrats saying, you guys lost, just suck it up and accept it. But if the 70 million people, whether you think their claims are valid or not, the Democrats, they may even be right, okay? We can go through all of this litigation. We can go through all of the lawsuits. We can spend the next month duking it out in courts. The Democrats could very well, I'm not saying that I believe this is going to happen, but they could, in 30 days from now, they could come out and say, look, we did everything you wanted. We audited everything. We responded to all your lawsuits. The judges heard everything. There's nothing to stand on, guys. You lost fair and square. If that were to happen, then that's awesome for the country. Okay, that's what we want. We don't want 70 million pissed off Donald Trump supporters who are going to say that this election was invalid no matter what. This has to be ironed out. Both these parties have to go in and club each other to the point of losing in order to make their case. And only through that process will we get some clarity on it. And that's better for everybody. So that's what I'm hoping that we see. And I don't think that, that the lawsuits are necessarily the end of the world. Like, this is just how lawyers communicate. And this is just the next step. We'll get through it. All right. Good question. We have one from Sarah Ann, another super chat. Thank you, Sarah Ann. Appreciate you being here. And she's asking, why are you not in Trump's legal team? It's a good question. Even if I got the invite, don't think that I'd want to dive into that can of worms, but yeah, they've got a lot of very qualified people, a lot of amazing people doing some very detailed work on it, and a lot more people that are a lot more qualified than I am. I am just your humble commentator. And by the way, I do criminal law also. So that's where my bread and butter is. All right. We have JR. JR's back. He says, the issue is the Trump supporters are going to say the result is invalid no matter what happens with the lawsuits. So I disagree with that, right? If the lawsuits come and go, I will be the first one to come back on this channel and say, there's nothing there. Trump lost fair and square. I'd be happy to do that if it is the case, but we're not there yet. There's more evidence. There's more information that we need to decipher in order to make that claim consciously. Now, the media is doing it and they're telling you can't even talk about it, which is a big part of the reason that we're having the conversation. If the media was having this conversation, there's no reason for us to have it here. All right. Where'd that go? All right. Chat's moving fast. The student who does calculus is back. He says, at R&R Law Group, I find it funny, a week ago the media wouldn't stop talking about COVID deaths, but now people can rally in thousands for an uncompleted election. Why doesn't Biden-Harris denounce it? Yeah, we talked about that yesterday. We showed some images of them actually, protesting in the streets. And largely, I was looking around the day after the election and even recently about, where are the COVID death counts, right? Every day on the Washington Post, it was more deaths. Every day Trump was running dead. Trump loses the election according to their own calls. Suddenly we're not talking about that so much anymore. All right. We have Sarah Ann who says, thank you for the response. You are doing a great job. Thank you, Sarah Ann. I really appreciate that. I appreciate two super chats out of you here today. Very generous of you. Very nice. Appreciate the nice compliments. And I'm glad you're here. Thanks for watching the program. We have James High who says, at Rob, play the Jim Crow Joe video on Discord. All right, we'll take a look at that one. I have not seen it. Linda Lauer says, how, when, and why did you start your channel? So we started this channel for a law firm a long time ago. I think in 2015 was one of my first videos. But watching The Watchers, this live show has only been going, I think, for 6 weeks, maybe. Miss Faith can double check me on that. Maybe 2 months. We started going live every day right around the time that Justice Ginsburg died, because we just knew that there's going to be so much heating up about her death, the confirmation of Amy Coney Barrett. And we had already been doing Watching the Watchers once weekly for a long period of time. We covered Rittenhouse, we covered Breonna Taylor, we covered Jacob Blake, we covered Rayshard Brooks. We covered a lot of cases, but we decided to go live every day as things started to heat up. And it's a lot of fun. We have a lot of great conversations, and there's a lot to talk about. And I think it's important. So we started doing the show every day, and we will continue to do that. So we have John Lauer, who says the PA Supreme Court, where'd that one go? Says the PA Supreme Court. Man, these comments are going fast. All right. John Lauer says the PA Supreme Court said that signature verification wasn't part of the election code. What do you say to that? So I actually haven't read the full opinion on the Pennsylvania Supreme Court case, because I know that it's going up to the U.S. Supreme Court. And the bits and pieces that I read out of it, if I can recall, it was a very long opinion. But largely what they were doing is they were saying that there's a sort of a relief valve in their state constitution that says that the judges can modify things in the event of a national emergency. So at a very high level, keep this in mind. The Constitution says that the state legislature governs the elections. The governor doesn't do it. The judge doesn't do it. So if the legislature says that the election takes place on November 3rd, that's when it takes place. The Pennsylvania Supreme Court came out and said, yeah, we know that. We can see in the rules that it says, yeah, it's on November 3rd, but we're going to use this little provision in our Constitution that says we have this extra power as part of the judiciary to reform things in order to provide what's called equitable relief. So the court can actually fashion a resolution, even though that's the job of the legislature. So that's what happened in Pennsylvania. And so I think that's what they're going to be leaning on. They're going to rely on that little pressure relief valve in their constitution to say, we didn't need to do these things. I think Judge Alito and I think the Supreme Court is going to reverse that. I don't think that they're going to be allowed to do that, but we will see. And so I would imagine that the reversal or the signature requirement would be a part of the Supreme Court's release valve. So in other words, they would say, yeah, if we have the authority to change the date of the election, we also have the authority to modify other things like a signature requirement. All right, we have we got some Rittenhouse comments here. We'll get back into Rittenhouse. He's kind of hanging tight in a holding pattern right now. We give updates on the cases that we follow when there are updates to pass along, but Rittenhouse is kind of in a holding pattern until we see some more developments on that. We've got some great super chats coming in. We have one from Sam from the UK. His username is SSWLAM. He says, thanks for a great channel. Real news. Even the media is so biased towards Biden. How can the media and big tech be made accountable? It's a great question. Couple thoughts on that. We talked a lot about Section 230 here. There's a previous episode where we talked about that. You know, I'm not particularly optimistic about that. I'm not particularly optimistic about big tech. I think big tech owns a large part of the senators and the representatives. I think that, you know, people rely on them who are running for office to get elected to office. And so the idea that a lot of our elected officials are going to push back on these big companies that keep them flush with cash in order to regulate them or clamp down on them a bit, I think it's a long shot, quite frankly. I think something catastrophic needs to happen. And we might be in the middle of it right now, right? We might be in the middle of the public waking up to this one-sided news media that we have, this one-sided kind of, they're creating a bubble around a large portion of the population to convince them of a certain thing happening. Even though many people are sort of like, wait, what? I had a lot of people reach out to me over this weekend. Is this right? Like, what's really going on here? And people are sort of waking up a little bit, kind of, you know, getting unplugged a little bit from the matrix, as it were. And I think until that happens, until there's a big push and people are just tired of it and they move to alternatives like Parler or like Rumble or, you know, any of these other platforms, I think it's difficult. You know, I'm not sure that Section 230 reform is something that would be even feasible given the current state of things. Now, things are very dynamic right now. So if there is a big revelation that, you know, that a lot of these votes were fraudulent, let's say, for example, you know, the Supreme Court case comes down, Pennsylvania has 3 days worth of votes thrown out. Another state finds 50,000 votes of fraud. Let's say Arizona comes back and it's actually a Trump win. And now Trump wins the White House, and the media has been parroting all of Joe Biden's stuff for the last, let's say, 3 or 4 weeks. The people would see that, I would hope, and they would say, those people are not credible anymore. I think a lot of people are recognizing that. The polls were wrong. All the media commentators were wrong. Nate Silver was wrong. Everybody was dramatically wrong. So every single day that, you know, that shows like this succeed, every single day that we have these conversations and that other people are creating content like this and starting new dialogues is a day that slowly but surely the population is kind of, you know, getting more awake, transitioning from those old forms of media into these new conversations that allow us to use our brains and to think and to reason and to use logic to say, well, maybe we should at least be talking about this. I don't need to come on this channel and start, you know, dropping the Sean Hannity talking points or the Rachel Maddow talking points. We can just talk through these issues, and it's a lot more of an effective way to communicate. And so I think as more and more people start to realize the mainstream is less and less credible by the day, other, you know, people will find different sources, and I think the country will be significantly better off as a result for it. Great question, Sam. So happy that you're watching from the UK. Appreciate you being here, and look forward to seeing more of you. Mr. Deplorable comes in with a super chat. He says, thanks for the balanced and well-informed analysis. Thank you, Mr. Deplorable. I appreciate that. You know, sometimes I feel like I may be a little bit too one-sided. I know I have my political biases, of course, but I try to be as objective as I can, and I try to at least make things about bigger than myself, right? In this case, we're talking about due process. We're talking about freedom. We're talking about election integrity. We're talking about, you know, voting, right? It's all super important. Those issues are way bigger in my mind than anything the Republicans are doing, than anything the Democrats are doing. They're way bigger concepts than Joe Biden or Donald Trump. I really don't, either way, if my fellow countrymen say Joe Biden is a better pick than Donald Trump, I'll live with that, as it was authentic, as long as it was credible. And if we have had the opportunity to validate the results and Joe Biden legitimately won, great. I'll be the first one to come on this channel and say, look, it looked great. Let's welcome him in. I want him to do well. I want the country to do well. I want people to be successful. I want people to do well in their lives. And I'm open to that conversation. So the idea that, you know, we need to die on political swords and kill each other over this political stuff is just ridiculous to me. But it's a good comment. Thank you for the super chat, Mr. Deplorable. We have another one from SSW Lamb. He says, keep up the great coverage and real news. That's two from him today. Thank you, Sam. Appreciate that. Donald M is back. He says, what are your thoughts on riding the dragon China secrets of Joe Biden and how it plays into this election after 4 years of Russia Trump collusion? What are your thoughts on riding the dragon? So I'm not sure I totally understand this question. One more time. What are your thoughts on riding the dragon China secrets of Joe Biden and how it plays into this election after 4 years of Russia Trump collusion? So I think the question is going towards this idea that, you know, a lot of the Democrats out there now are saying that they want unity and they want, empathy and healing. Now it's a time to come together and we all need to move forward beyond this election. And that kind of, you know, I'm not sure that many people are quite there yet. Remember, they've been calling Donald Trump supporters racists and bigots and xenophobes and Russian conspirators for the last basically 5 years, you know, ever since the election took place. And even before the election, they were saying all of those things. So 70 million Donald Trump supporters who've been called racist for 4 years. Are they just going to go, okay, yeah, all right, Joe, now that you're president, I get you're right. Let's all come together. Let's sing kumbaya and let's move this thing forward. I don't think that's the case. And if they also think that the election, it was fraudulent on top of them being insulted for 4 years, now they also have an illegitimate president, it is not good for the country. That's why I'm saying this is so important that we get to the bottom of this. Okay. And we may get to the bottom of it, and it may be Joe Biden was lawfully and legitimately elected. Great, great news. That means that our elections are secure. We have nobody interfering with them. Let's all move forward with that. But we're not there yet, and there's still a little bit of time to go on that. Good question, though. Another super chat from S. McKay says, do you think Attorney General Barr will do an intentionally rotten investigation in order to snuff out any legitimate claims of election fraud? Thanks. So I think the question is going towards, you know, do you think that Barr is going to do an actual a good investigation? So, in other words, is he going to go in there and hold people's feet to the fire and ask them to get to the bottom of it? I don't think so, right? We saw in his memorandum, we read the memo at the very early part of the show. In his memo, he was just sort of fleshing out some loose guidelines. for prosecutors to go in and do their own investigations, sort of unshackling them a little bit. Remember, the prior DOJ policy was that you consult with a different board. It's called the Election Crimes Board. So before a prosecutor who's a part of the DOJ is able to go do that, they were supposed to go and have a consultation with that separate division. Now, what Attorney General Barr has done is he's basically lifted up that restriction and he's given them new guidelines. And he says it needs to be two things, right? Several things. It can't be specious. It can't be, sort of abstract. It needs to be concrete, and it needs to be something that could potentially impact the outcome of the election. So kind of high bars there in order for them to go and do something. Now, if I were a U.S. attorney in the Department of Justice, and I had some purview or some jurisdiction over election crimes, as hungry and as ambitious as I like to think I am, I think that I would be going in and, diving through that stuff to help sort of make a name for myself and move up in the Department of Justice, right? That's how you become a good prosecutor, is you are successful, right? You have a good caseload, you have a lot of wins, you go and find new things, you do justice. That's what the theory is. And so you would imagine that that would be taking place all over the place in the Department of Justice, but I don't know about that. I think a lot of the Department of Justice are probably a lot of holdovers, probably a lot of Democrats, probably a lot of people who would be okay if Donald Trump wasn't reelected. So, I don't know. I don't know what the makeup of the DOJ is. I don't know. I will tell you that traditionally, lawyers in general are pretty liberal, right? They have a lot of empathy, a lot of justice talk, a lot of social justice in particular. So I'm not particularly sure that the DOJ is filled with a bunch of Trump supporters. I don't think that it is. And even though Attorney General William Barr lifted the shackles up a little bit, I'm not sure that anybody's going to run with that. All right. So Donald is clarifying his last question. Before I move on, good question, SMK. Thank you for that. We'll see. We're going to see what it turns up. Donald's back. He says, Riding the Dragon is a Joe Biden documentary of Biden family and China corruption. So I have not seen that one. I will take a look at that, Donald. Thanks for bringing that up. It's called Riding the Dragon. We'll take a look at that. Prior to the election, we covered some of the Hunter Biden stuff. We cover what's in the news. And if people who are elected officials, if they're doing bad things and maybe they're doing things that are dangerous for the country, or they're operating in a different system of justice than you or I, we want to make sure that they're being held to account. And that's why we covered some of that. But a good question. Thanks, Donald. Thanks for clarifying that. All right. We got Mr. G, who said Donald Trump lost. Get over it. We have Eric Petty, who says, then how come you're talking about voter fraud and won't bring up the fraud committed by the GOP when actively put out ballot drop boxes and were told to remove them and refused? So that's from Eric Petty. So, Eric, I haven't seen that. But again, an investigation into voter fraud is across the board. I'm not just saying that the Republicans go and investigate the Democrats. I think they should investigate everything. They should investigate the whole election, every vote, every mail source, everywhere it came from. If the Republicans start investigating this and they find out that the Republicans were doing it, we want to know about that. And so in my mind, this is not a partisan issue. I think that the public has a lot of questions about the election, and having a deeper conversation, doing a deeper analysis, duking some of this stuff out in court is not a bad thing. And the Democrats, they don't have to sit on the sidelines while the Republicans go into the buffet and feast themselves to death on this stuff. The Democrats, if they've got a problem with what you say is a problem, if you say it was GOP fraud and there's a ballot drop box problem and there's all this, all those things, that's voter fraud, right? We want that uncovered. I don't care who's doing it. I don't care if it's Russia, China, Joe Biden, Donald Trump, whomever. I don't care. But we do want to know what is happening here, because a lot of information is coming out that says that it seems a little bit wonky, may not be exactly on point or as credible as everybody claims it is. So let's go investigate it. If the Republicans are responsible for it, they should be held accountable also. And the Democrats should be doing that. If there are states that Donald Trump just barely won and they think it's fraud, where are their lawsuits? Where are their Benford Law people? Where are they? Let's hear from them. I'd love to cover them on the channel. You can send them to me, put them in Discord, send them over to Faith, send them to tips@rrlawaz.com. I'll look at all of it. All right. JB says, for anyone doubting potential for fraud, if you are counting ballots for Hitler and Biden, is it not a moral, ethical imperative to stop Hitler? Is Trump basically Hitler to a large swath of the left? Yeah, and so this is an interesting argument, right? People who are largely a part of the left are saying, Donald Trump is the worst thing that's ever happened to America. Donald Trump is Hitler. Donald Trump is a racist. He wants to put kids in cages and all this stuff. And so it's kind of a like, it's kind of hard to have it both ways, right? If you think that somebody is Hitler and you had control of some votes, wouldn't it be a moral obligation? Don't you have a moral duty, an ethical imperative to help get Hitler out of office, right? And so if you think that way and you're in Philadelphia and you're looking at a bunch of Trump ballots right in front of you and you say, Donald Trump's Hitler, and I've got 1,000 Donald Trump ballots here, and Hitler's responsible for killing millions and millions of people, and I can do something about this to avoid the next Hitler. And maybe you just take that stack of ballots and you just do something with them, right? How could you not, if you legitimately thought that Donald Trump was Hitler and ruining America, how could you not throw those ballots out, right? You'd be a coward. You would be somebody who is, you know, weak in the face of horror. And so you'd have to get rid of those ballots. So what is it? Is Donald Trump Hitler, or did you throw the ballots out? If you didn't throw the ballots out, then you may think that Donald Trump is not Hitler. So it's kind of a weird argument, right? So there's a lot of motive there, because for the last, I don't know how many years, they've been saying stuff like that, and a lot of people believe it. And if those people are in a position of power, we talked about this, motive, means, and opportunity. If they've got the motive because they think they're defeating the next Nazi Hitler, it's a pretty good motive. It's a good question. And it's going to be curious how they reconcile those two. We have another super chat. Thanks, everybody, today. A lot of super chats coming in from Charles Ashley. Says, could media's interference in the election process be considered as treason, especially if their narrative was intentionally to hide the truth? So I don't think that you could charge, you know, the abstract media with treason. I don't think that it necessarily equates to treason. I think, you know, treason would be something that's very concrete. You know, somebody in the media was calling it for Donald Trump or calling it for Joe Biden because he was paid off by the Chinese or something like that, right? In order to install Joe Biden, in order to, you know, lessen the sanctions that Donald Trump had put on China, Joe Biden's going to reverse those. And so you'd have to have this big conspiracy thing going on. And the standard there would be a lot higher, right? So treason's a very serious charge. It's a crime. It's punishable by death. You know, it's serious. And the idea that the media is out there just kind of putting out opinions, I think that's all covered by the First Amendment. They're all entitled to that. They're all entitled to do those things. And even though you and I may look at it and say, you know, it feels like they're trying to manipulate things a little bit, they're sort of going on with this story that's not exactly factually accurate just now. It feels a little bit manipulative, but I don't think that it rises to the level of treason. But I can understand why people would be very angry with them and why people are canceling their cable and turning off Fox News and kind of running away from all of them, because it does feel, I would say, ingenuine. It does feel like it's less than authentic, and people are starting to realize that. It's a good question, though. We will see what continues to happen. All right, everybody, I am going to wrap it up right there. I want to thank you all for joining us. We're going to be back here at the same time tomorrow and the rest of the week. We do this at 4 p.m. Pacific time, 5 p.m. Arizona time, 6 p.m. Central time, which is those of you, I think, out there in Texas, 7 p.m. Eastern time. So mark your calendars on that. Put that on here. We're here every day. We try not to miss. We miss every now and then, but we're getting into a routine because we got to keep talking about these things because there is so much to digest and so much to make sense of. And there's a lot of work to do for a lot of people. So if you want to help the show, I'd love it if you would share it. If you just, you know, share this show, send the YouTube link to a family member or a friend. In particular, there's some good information in this show that they can actually look up, right? So we talked about maidengate and we talked about some of the data from Brayford. And if you send those little links or send those clips, and Miss Faith, after the show, she actually goes and she does a table of contents and timestamps everything. So maybe send those to your, you know, to your family members, send those to your mom, to your sister, people who may be divorced or married or changed their names. Maybe see if they're interested in looking their stuff up and they may contribute to the investigation. Not a bad idea. We've got one more super chat from Jim Hamill. He says, with the same logic, can Trump be charged with treason for falsely claiming victory and trying to steal the election? So I don't think that would be, again, falsely claiming victory. I don't know that that's a crime, right? You can claim it. Now, if Donald Trump tries to stay in the White House because he's not the president anymore, that would be an action, right? Right now, he's saying that we're going to win, right? He's still claiming that we're going to win. I have not seen anything saying I'm not leaving the White House. not leaving the White House, again, I don't know that that would amount to treason, maybe some sort of an obstruction charge. Nobody's ever done it as far as I know, so I don't know what the criminal charge would be on that. But treason is sort of selling your country out to a foreign power. So the idea that Donald Trump is still standing by his victory and is not going to be, you know, leaving or trying to steal the election, I don't know that that would be treason because he's not really selling the country out to someone else. He's just sort of overstaying his welcome. And I think there are different remedies for that. And hopefully we don't need to dive into that a little bit further. Hopefully that this thing gets resolved and we have a peaceful transition of power, but we've got a lot more work to do. So we have Linda Faye who has dropped off two super chats, no questions, coming in from Linda Faye. Linda F-A-Y-E. Thank you so much. I appreciate that. Thanks, Linda. Appreciate you being here. Once again, everybody, if you're not already a subscriber, hit the subscribe button. We love that when you do that. Hit that like button as well. We're going to be back here tomorrow. Same time, same place for more on this. And also, don't forget to join the Discord channel because the conversations continue both before and after the show over there. And the Discord channel is in the link below. So I want to thank you once again for being a part of the program. It's a lot of fun. Faith and I have a great time. Thank you to Faith. Thank you to Ma the Fox for helping me keep the train on the tracks. And we have another super chat that just came in. Let me get it. Two more that just came in. Okay. We have the Reaper Son who said, "What we are witnessing is an ideological coup, the propaganda arm of the Democrat Party. Trump warned early on that they would be doing this." Yeah, they did. So Donald Trump said that, you know, the propaganda arm, it, you know, that's a charged term, but it sort of does feel like that. We talked about this yesterday and I have the image on my Twitter account, the scale of legitimacy that comes from the Reaper's Son. So take a look at that. You know, they're really trying to make this thing look legitimate, even though it's not over yet. You know, they're really, really pushing hard. Joe Biden, his dog is coming into the White House now. Office of the President-elect, all the world leaders are congratulating him. People are cheering in the streets. Life's amazing. Joe Biden, yay! And we're not there just quite yet. So it does feel a little bit like propaganda, but we'll see where it goes. We have Jim Hamill who says, "What are the chances Trump faces charges after January 20th if he is no longer president?" So good question. You know, I haven't looked into that recently. I don't know where they're at with the Southern District of New York. My understanding is in Southern District of New York was where they were doing investigations into some tax fraud and those types of things. Not sure where that lawsuit stands or what that, I think it was a district attorney or a U.S. attorney out of Pennsylvania was there and or was contemplating bringing charges. So I'm not sure where that stands. But the bigger question, Jim, is whether or not Donald Trump pardons himself before he leaves office. Okay, that's the bigger question. Is he going to pardon himself? Is he going to pardon his family? Is he going to pardon, you know, General Flynn, Julian Assange, Edward Snowden? What's going to happen there? If he pardons himself, I don't think that's ever happened in the United States. And I don't think there's any Supreme Court precedent on that. Is he even allowed to do that? If he's allowed to do it and he pardons himself, well, then you've got no, he can't face any charges. But we don't know if that's going to happen. That's, again, presuming that he leaves office and we're not there quite yet. But it's a good question, Jim. Thank you so much for asking that. All right. Linda Faye dropped another one, it looks like. And I think that is it for me, everybody. Thanks once again. One more reminder to subscribe and join us over on Discord. Everybody have an awesome, it's not weekend yet. We got a whole lot of week left. Have an awesome night. I'll see everybody tomorrow. Thanks.